welcome to our brand new show, In the Ring, where we are going to start conversations about important topics concerning the travel and tourism industry. Today, our industry expert panel is Mr. Amish Desai, Mr. Manoj, Mathew, Anil, Kumar, and Ms. Ranjini, Nambiar. Coronavirus, the pandemic has brought the travel industry to its knees. And today we have an expert panel here where we're going to discuss on how the industry is going to react, recover and move forward. So Amish, from a TAAI's perspective as well as your personal perspective, what's your view on how industry is going to cope and how we are able to jump back?
See, basically Arun, I'm not qualified to speak on behalf of TAAI, though I'm the chairman of TAAI in Karnataka. But this is something which has really taken us by surprise. I mean, anyone everywhere will tell you that this has never happened before in our industry. So this is a first. Very, very tough times. And we are still grappling with the situation. I don't think anyone can really say that, yes, I've decided what I'm going to do over the next 3 months when this is still going to be in force. But yeah, we all need to be on our toes. These are still early days. According to me, it's going to be another couple of months of pain for every one of us in the industry. I'm sure all the fellow panelists will agree. It's not going to be easy to handle this. And yes, I've heard people say tough decisions like layoffs and retrenchment. And I guess each to his own there. But on a macro level, the most important thing for us right now is to hang in there and actually say this too will pass. For the time being, it's only that. And I myself personally also am not really able to think of what I am going to do. I've come up with ideas like, okay, maybe reskill the staff, teach them something new, teach each person another activity within the workplace or whatever. But overall, it's very difficult right now, I think, for me to even say what I plan to do. As an association, of course, TAAI has been doing a lot of work representing with the government for, you know, some kind of tax breaks and stuff like that. That's an ongoing process. And like I said, these are early days. It's going to take time, but hopefully the government will hear us and some kind of relief will come to the agency.
So, I'll just move on to Mr. Mathew. From a hotel industry perspective, how ready is the hotel industry to handle this?
Anybody coughs or sneezes, we catch the cold. So the hoteliers are always the first people to understand how the industry is reacting. And this has been a calamity of humongous proportions. And it's a global phenomenon where it's across industry. It's not even restricted to tourism. You name it and everybody is impacted. So for us, we have put a pause button because, like my colleague said, that everybody is perplexed at the changing dynamics every day. We don't know how serious or how severe it is. The government, the agencies are gaping, and the only sad part is we also have to tackle fake news and rumors, which is hitting the industry very bad. So we don't really know if it's so bad. But the media is unpunishing when it comes to finding out which are the news which is trustworthy and facts, so that the people are perceptions are not so disastrous. Mm-hmm. Because hoteliers have kind of put the pause button because there are hardly any occupancies, between 5% and 10% occupancies, and the numerous aspects to it, hygiene factors. So we have to actually relook, go back to the drawing board and see how do we do business, what are our in such emergency preparedness, business continuity. These are some of those very basic questions that we'll have to relook and work.
So this is a question for both Ranjini and Anil. If you look at NASSCOM, If you look at the pharmaceutical sector or the aviation sector, aviation manufacturing sector, right? Everybody's done at some point of time, have foreseen and they've been prepared for such scenarios, right? And do you think SKAL as an organization, that since it's a global organization, have you all had a plan or vision to counter such pandemic?
Doing business, the vision is about doing business. So when we look at it, we look at on an interpersonal level. So we have actually a fund which is to handle your personal calamities and your personal, like suppose a situation arises, you fall sick, or your business, you have incurred a business loss. So we do, you could apply for a fund, and SKAL International sends you a fund for that to, you know, to tide through that situation.
So,
but when you're looking at this kind of a pandemic situation, honestly speaking, we do not have, because here everybody is affected at the same level. I mean, I can't say that one person's business is, the loss is, you know, outweighing the other, but I think pretty much everybody is grappling through the same situation.
My question is more collective as an industry, right? We, as travel industry, have we been naive about it? We have not prepared the leadership, our team across associations and forums, not have a vision for something like this and put a plan in place?
We did, you know what, strangely, if you're looking at it, I think when the floods occurred, we put a vision for that, and we said for natural calamities, we created a fund out of the sponsorships which we raised. We would keep aside a 10% to handle when Kerala grappled through the flood situation, and Karnataka went in through. So we could keep aside.
Those
so
are more philanthropic in nature.
Philanthropic,
you know,
exactly.
You're talking about is a disaster management plan.
Yeah.
But this scale of disaster is something I don't think any of us had even thought.
None of us.
I think this has made the humanity look at the way things are. Because I think all of us, as from all sectors, not only tourism, all sectors are equally to blame for what has happened. We have not taken these aspects seriously. We have not looked at the infrastructure of medical, we've not invested money in research in vaccines, though there are alarm bells ringing. So this is just one of the calamities. I'm sure if we don't, that's why I said probably all of us will have to go back to the drawing board and see how do we work, what are some of those practices that we need to incorporate in our daily life. We are not very so conscious about social distancing, we're conscious about hygiene. Why isn't that the way of life? It's so easy to, even it's so easy to kill a common cough and cold. But these things are there because we take everything so much casual and for granted. No. I think, so tourism is just a reflection of the society, because everybody comes to places, in our places to come and enjoy, but this is what happens.
So, are you suggesting, I'm just going to defocus from individual personal habits back into the question of disaster management and being prepared for it. Do you think as an industry we've been naive about it?
That's no, I'm trying to say another way. In fact, when they talk about stock markets, if you ask a person who's investing in stocks, what do they say? Do not place all the eggs in one basket, right? So I guess at this particular point of time, I've seen a lot of travel agents or travel partners do dabble in different kinds of businesses. Probably, I feel on a hindsight, probably it's nice. I'm just a wild thinking to have an alternate parallel kind of a, you know,
I don't think
a business
in this scenario. You're
even that is not. Yeah, everything has got a cascading
effect. Everything has been hit right across the board.
Yeah, I know, but I'm just talking about, like, a lot of people do. Or I've seen a lot of people in the, at least in Bombay, I've seen a lot of travel partners have multiple businesses.
Yes.
You understood,
yes,
I think.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying.
Yes. So, yeah, it's not about multiple business. My question, I'm going to just push it back again.
No,
saying,
I will tell you why. Uh-huh. Because it's individually, if you ask me right now, for me, this is my only livelihood. So I have to.
So why didn't we learn out of Ebola, SARS, swine flu, and that we should have taken a leash out of those?
Arun, that's what, coming back
to you.
Disaster management is actually a postmortem. I am questioning the fact, why are we allowing disasters to happen? again and again and again. I'm saying that I think we probably should look at the root cause of the way we do business, the way we conduct ourselves as human beings. I think those moot questions are now something that we have to start from. Not from the
fair
fact
point.
That...
That's
not
a
from
very,
the fact
again,
that,
I would push yeah. back and say that's a very personal, individual
I'm saying
perspective.
Not,
where it's about your hygiene factors, etc. Right?
Yeah.
My question, again, the pushback from TAAI's perspective, from SKAL, from the hotel industry perspective, from an organizational perspective. My question is, why didn't we learn out of past...
Ebola or the SARS?
Yeah, SARS, Ebola, etc.
Unfortunately, I think we are talking about Ebola and swine flu and other epidemics has happened, not in India, it has happened in South Africa as well as in Spain. So unfortunately we thought it is not going to affect us, so we didn't learn out of it. But unfortunately this is a COVID-19 which has happened in forest. We are thinking this is going to be sustained over there only. We never thought it will come to India, it will go to Europe and it will go to USA. Unfortunately it has happened across the world.
The globe,
so
yeah.
Now to control, so everybody has to join hands and do something. But as you are saying, the what industry will do for this. But unfortunately, looking at the any developed countries, they couldn't do anything immediately. It is like for everybody, it is like in a startup, because in one shot it has hit everybody. But I would like to congratulate India for that reason, because India is doing a fantastic job to curtail this disease to expand across the all states. So, but we as an association, we are to as a disaster for the travel agents so badly, because as you're saying, what is the precautionary you're taken? So what else we can do? Because this is our industry is not in a very rich industry like a real estate or something like that. Once you do in a business, you get so much of money, you can keep it somewhere and do all that thing. So our business is, maximum, 2-3 months you can survive whatever you have saved.
Now, coming to your question, Arun, I think in terms of my perspective, when you talk about disaster management, we all have disaster management plans, like say, industry specific. So if tomorrow an airline goes bust, yes, there are some, weapons which we have, or say, we have something called a joint bank guarantee for agents.
Mm-hmm.
Those kind of things are there. But this is a much bigger thing.
Yeah.
I mean, let's be honest, let's look at it a very simple way. SARS was an epidemic. Swine flu was an epidemic. This is a pandemic. So for anyone to be ready for something as huge as this, I don't think anyone thought about it.
Fair point, but... So I'll just take a leaf out of what Anil just mentioned, right? India has done a commendable job. That's yet to see.
Everything it is available, and he was appreciating so much, and it is not an a, it is an a fact. So looking all those things, as well as the states also, they are taking a lot of precautionary. States, every state is doing, like Karnataka, like Maharashtra, any state you name it, they are doing it. So with all this, together effortness of all the states and as well as the support from the center, so I think, this will not go beyond our control. That's what I feel.
Well, assuming it will not go beyond our control, but unfortunately, industry is down on its knee.
Absolutely.
So do you all think our government is doing enough for the industry?
No.
Is government rolling out a stimulus package?
At this stage, I would say, we are sometimes known as crybabies. I'm not talking about the travel industry, but in general, Indian businessmen are known to be crybabies. But here we are not crying. Here we are actually on our knees, and we need the government to come in with support. I mean, tax breaks are very, very important. It's extremely important. Also,
can you elaborate on the tax
break? See, the first thing to do is to come down with a GST break. The cost of each of the travel components, if you give a break of, say, 12 months on GST, one of the major things which the government could look at is across the industry, maybe a 2 or 3% cut in the interest rate people are paying on their, say, OD limits or on their... loans. Now these are things which will give them breathers, and this is the disaster management plan which you're talking about. In this scenario, it has to come from the government. No industry association, no industry group can do something as big as that, as what is required right now. We are going to see Like I said, some people are talking about retrenchment and loss of jobs.
Yes.
There's already an article, I think it's by IATA itself, that there will be 50 million jobs lost across the world. Now, no industry association can sustain that. But if, when you have something like Manrega or something of that kind in India, why can't we start looking at that as an option and subsidize salaries? I'm not talking of everyone, I'm not talking management level or something, but anyone who's drawing a salary of less than 20,000 in a hotel or a travel industry or wherever it is, 10,000 rupees right now you as the promoter pay, 10,000 rupees comes from a government fund. That gives you a little bit of a breather. And in this situation, we can only look at the government. Individually, we cannot do anything, and not at this level.
I don't think so. That kind of a level of, you know, profit margins and that kind of a level, it's we don't function at that level. That's the where the industry, as it is, industry has been in the past. If you look at the tourism industry, not from the travel agent perspective, the travel agents. If you look at it, your commissions had been gone. Most of the airlines had gone on to the zero commission level. Tour operators were grappling with the issue of the online systems. So on top of this, imagine if you would have further disaster, you know, pandemic situation like this. What are we going to work on? In fact, that is what exactly I totally agree with Amish on when he said that the government, if you ask, the Australian government is already released, Japan is released, Singapore has released,
US.
And Canada has released. Already, all the tax
for
benefits
for the travel,
yeah. Yes, absolutely. If you read the bill I've received from a friend of mine who works there with the government, who sent me the bill, and we had in fact forwarded the same to the Maharashtra a principal secretary who heads the tourism. I had forwarded the same bill to them so that, you know, the government could look at it.
I'm saying that for the Indian government, our system is very complex. There are state governments and
yeah,
there are
you have different taxations.
So I guess this is one time, and I guess that each one of them is trying to see how far they need to stretch, how much they have to open their purse strings.
Mm-hmm.
So because it, while we can talk confidently about the tourism sector, the other industries are also grappling with similar concessions. So government is trying to see that how much of the pie it has to give to each one of them.
Sure.
That's one. I think the fact of the matter is there are two aspects to it. One is how far they can support the different industries, and tourism is a huge sector because it combines a lot of other things. If you take Karnataka, I think 10 to 11 lakh people will be on the streets in another 4 months if things are going to go down. Because we have more than 20 lakhs people in this tourism industry in Karnataka alone.
60,000 travel agents in India.
So this
right.
is going to, yeah, it is It is going to be extremely, extremely tough.
At stake.
The second part that the government will have to do is once the cleanup happens is they will have to make this a tax-free nation for some time to attract tourists. They say that this is, we know you've suffered, we know it's time, come to a land of peace, harmony and diversity and come and enjoy a tax-free holiday. If they do that, it becomes a big campaign and solves a problem for a lot of us, and I think some kind of a relief everybody gets.
So what you're suggesting is one is obviously roll out a stimulus package.
Yeah. Which includes state and the central government.
Central government. And number two is to give tax breaks.
Yeah.
Make it a tax-free destination for 6 to 8 months.
Okay. So tax-free is another big term that's been used,
yeah.
Right? So again, if you were to break that down further, you have taxes on hotels, right? They are luxury and non-luxury hotel, taxes on transactions, taxes on bookings.
No taxes.
So which ones?
No taxes. No taxes on rooms. No taxes on anything. So what happens is, you have people coming, so there is a revenue generated. So that itself will give them.
Unfortunately, Indian government, India country, is not very keen on travel and tourism. That is unfortunate for all the people who are in this trade, because always they think it is in a commercial product.
You know, that's you not the primary industry.
Business with airline, focus. Business within a tourism department. You make money and you decide what you wanted. Even government says it is a commercial, so we can't intervene. You want to negotiate with the airline, you negotiate yourself. So in this scenario, unless this our industry gets an industrial status recognized by India as well as the state, then only we may get these kind of benefits like tax and all. But government will say that how can they, you know, reduce the tax or abolish the tax, because the government and country runs out of tax only. So they can give like subsidies, like, you know, visa on arrival free, or they may say, you know, the little reduction in the hotel taxes, or the hoteliers voluntarily they come up and they say that we have reduced the hotel tariffs, please visit India and enjoy
yourself.
Sorry,
but I think that's step two.
Step one is
keep me alive.
Yeah.
Step one.
Yeah.
I have to be alive.
Alive
for that to happen.
That.
So yeah, step one is where the government has to come in with something and say, here's
exactly.
Your oxygen.
Yes.
Live on this for the next
for the
3
next
months, so that then I can come back and do this kind of
thing. The thing is, you know, what has happened now presently, the government is very keen on how to, you know, keep alive all the people in the country. They are not bothered whether you are suffering or you are happening something to you. You do on your own as a priority. I think every country is doing the same thing. India also is doing. I'm not saying that they should not support us. We will be welcome that, you know, if they want to support, give us subsidies, we will take it. But present situation is not happening. But, you know, already
there is no relief which has been there is no relief fund which has been set,
so
as you said.
Have we reached out to the government as an industry?
Yes,
yes, as an industry.
It has been represented already.
So I think too many people are represented with too many requests and demands, and at this point of time there is absolutely no time to even look at that. They just are firefighting themselves to
yes.
control this yes. pandemic. So right now I think it is not a stage where they have reached to say that okay, we'll give this. Right now they want to see whether they can curtail the damage,
curtail the
damage.
Spread of the damage, the spread
so that
of the,
because
yeah.
every time this spreads in India, in a country like India, if it spreads, I'm telling you, no government will be able to, we'll have to look at somebody else to help us. Unfortunately, everybody's in the state, so we'll have to look at ourselves.
So, can I summarize this by saying it's going to be a public-private cooperation that's
yes.
going to lead the road to recovery?
I would suggest, I fully agree with Manoj, right now the government can't do anything because they're concentrating on something which is a lot more important.
Mm-hmm.
So the next month and a half, we need to go into our pockets, survive, keep our offices going, our staff going. But by that point of time, we will be neck deep. And that is where some kind of a plan has to come in on a larger level for the industry as a whole. After 2 months, max 3 months, I don't see individual players, at least in the industry, being able to survive without some kind of help coming in terms of a stimulus package, in terms of some kind of, like I said, you know, loan moratoriums or something. We are not asking for anything to be written off.
Mm-hmm.
Don't write off my loan. Give me a moratorium.
So
I will not pay for, you don't need to repay your loan for the next 1 year, just pay your interest at a low, something of that kind. So I fully agree, 1.5-2 months, the government's attention needs to also be in that area. Please go right ahead, but start looking at this industry, because this industry is going to face the brunt of it.
Because anything which happens, I think, first if you look at any corporate, anything, if you see any particular disaster, any particular, you know, the travel is the first, forget the pandemic, anything which happens in the world, travel industry is the first to have the cut. Anything which happens.
The state government will not do some micro-segmenting.
Mm-hmm.
So because he has to tackle a guy who is a driver come owner of a taxi,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
a hotelier, single owner hotel, and he has to tackle the chain. So they'll have to do some micro-segmenting in the state government. The state government will have to recommend where they can't do much mm-hmm. to the central government.
Yes.
So there has to be a lot of communication, honest communication going between these two. And then the associations should also give honest recommendations. This is not the time to line your pockets. This is a time to give help to the relevant people who actually can't survive. It is not for a person who's got something and who wants
but then
something
how,
more.
It's a humongous
yeah, exercise.
They'll have to
formulate a framework that next time they know, although this will help them to reach out to.
No, but Manoj, how do you identify who's needy?
That's what I'm saying.
They have to put in.
Otherwise, it's not possible to look at it industry-wise alone.
So if you look at a central unified taxation itself, everybody's been fighting, isn't it? Transportation itself, we have been asking for across states for a transportation unified. Because if you go from Karnataka to Kerala, for example, there's a huge, or to Tamil Nadu, there's a huge taxation difference. So even that we've not been able to grapple. So what are we talking about?
So can we learn out of this?
Absolutely.
Instead of having multiple voices and going to the government, can we have a collective voice? I know of faith. But my question to you, Ranjini, I'm not sure if faith is, SKAL is part of faith.
No.
SKAL doesn't need to be. Like
no.
You said, SKAL is an individual.
Individual membership.
So
that's the reason.
So each one of them is in a way represented by faith, because it is the Tourism and Hospitality Association. So I guess we are all in a way represented by faith. So hopefully the government will take the recommendations of faith seriously.
Yeah.
We are certainly working faithfully. So so hopefully things
hopefully
will be looked at.
You'll be our
hopefully faithfully we get
faithfully
something.
We'll get something. Yes.
Okay. So while we approach, while faith approaches the government faithfully and gets the things done, what is your advice to the travel agent out there? What he or she should do right now from a survival perspective, apart from the basic stuff? Because I've seen messages saying update your Facebook page, website. I think that's irrelevant for survival, right?
Yeah.
So what are three steps or 3 points that they should look at? I'll start with you, Amish, and then
three points. I'm grappling thinking of one point.
Yeah.
What to do, except for the fact that I keep telling myself I have to go into my reserves to keep myself and my staff and my office alive for the next 3 months. All that I've earned over the last few years is going to get used up here, and I'll probably have to start almost from a clean slate. It's like almost, you know, when you start a new business, you put aside a certain amount as working capital for 3 months, saying, assuming no sales, this is the money I'm putting aside. That's probably the only thing I can think of, because there is just nothing else. I mean, apart from like what you said, update my website, or like I said earlier, try and reskill the employees, teach them new skills or something of that kind. Apart from that, there's really nothing else that at least I'm able to think of right now. Going down, I'm not very sure, but right now I'm really at a loss of what one can really do.
Your technology.
Yeah, it's actually, I can think of 33 things, not three things, that needs to be done. But the first thing is to cut your losses. Actually, everything is a loss now. Cut your losses, cut your fat, go down to basics. How do you make sure that you're able to take care of the people who have been with you? That's the biggest concern now, is to ensure that your talent
stays with you
so that once all this is over, you can still continue after licking your wounds and starting again. So that is the first thing that we need to look. The second thing that probably we'll have to do is that look at the way we do business. We should have a backup plan. There is no way anybody can get in a situation like this where you're so helpless. All of us are extremely helpless and vulnerable now. I think that is a very uncomfortable position, this vulnerability. So probably it's time to look at each other. We should synergize and we should look across segments. Not only I'm saying, so tourism probably will have to look at some other industry for support. So I think it's time to look at the whole way we do business with each other, so that at times like this, we are able to help. This is all I can say.
Yeah, this is a very critical position we are there, because it is very difficult now. The people are working with us from many years, say about 8 to 15 years the people are working, Now, you know, go to them and ask them to reduce your salary or work from home without loss of pay. It makes, you know, it is because it's already we are built as in a family. So now it is becoming a highly difficult task for a management to, you know, go and talk to them. But I feel that as an advice, we have done a business from so many years. So we have to, like, you know, when you start in a company, you invest money. Now you think that you're starting in a company, reinvest something and take care of the offices at least for 2-3 months. Afterwards, you can take drastic steps, removing staff or reducing salary. But we should keep them happy at least for 3 months, you know, because they are loyal for you for so many years. So we cannot just say that, you know, because of these things, you know, we can't keep you longer and I have to reduce your salary. So that is my view.
And Ranjini, your deal?
I think my deal is, I would say that I totally agree that I think staff is our biggest concern, which everybody feels. Talent should stay in for the next couple of months. You need to take care of them, but I'm sure a lot of their livelihood depends upon us. So I would think that, you know, you could keep them aside, maybe with a slight cut in the salary and retain them for some time, and then we grapple with that situation. And then I think the future, I look at it, I would look at it strongly in saying collaboration, basically. In collaborate with different talents, I would say that we all work with multitasking with one industry. I mean, I've been 20 years in this industry. I used to handle tickets to holidays, to visas, to everything. And my, you know, all of us, and, you know, so much amount of, you know, time went in managing, micromanaging entire industry. So now I think over the past 3 years, what I've noticed is I started moving and I'm saying that there is talent. Now you will see a lot of people coming in with exclusive visa, you know, services providers, like, you know, companies, couple of companies have come. So I think we should just give them, you know, we should break it down. Who's the strength, understand their strength and work with them, and we work as a team.
So just to summarize all your points, I would say this is what I understood. One is to cut your losses and learn to survive.
Absolutely.
Two, retain and reskill your talent.
Sure.
And three, just wait and watch what happens next.
Absolutely.
Right? That's a little bit different.
Absolutely.
And also look at your business model.
Mm-hmm.
You will have to critically look at your business model.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because it's just too risky anymore.
And like she said, specialization.
Yeah.
But you know, the only sad part is it's only when something of this kind happens that we talk like this. The moment
Absolutely.
That V-turn takes place, things start mm-hmm. going back.
Everybody's got back
so
into that.
Hopefully, this time, this one is a huge impact. So hopefully, I think we'll all learn our lessons.
Absolutely. This is a bigger, really big lesson.
I hear something there. Are you suggesting that after this pandemic goes down and the industry manages to survive and when it's back on
the ground.
One, do you all think there's going to be a correction in terms of model like you mentioned? Two, in terms of people like airlines, will they realize the importance of an agent because they are going to go up again? You know, they need agent support to fly back up there.
Mm-hmm.
Hence, they will open up and start rolling out commissions. Do you think that those kind of corrections
wishful
will happen?
Wishful thinking,
but I wish.
Sure. Exactly.
I wish. Seriously wish.
I don't think that would happen, but we'll have to work amongst ourselves.
Yes,
we need to, like I said, skill up, specialize. And what you said earlier, I think we all need to now start thinking, in case there is another situation like this, we should be ready for that.
Ready
but
for that.
I think this will be the start.
Mm-hmm.
The drawing board will be now.
No.
We've not done it till now, but
till
this
now
may be where
it.
We'll come up with it.
So, so from a agency perspective, I think it's a survival of the fittest right now, tough times. From a hotel perspective, what's your take on it? What's your parting message on that?
I think that we've had difficult guests and we wished to exit from the industry sometimes when we have these guests.
Uh-huh.
We should look at it as a bad dream. It's a nightmare, not a dream. But I think it's just hold on there and don't forget your values, don't forget your fundamentals. I think everybody needs a hotel room. Everybody has to travel.
Mm-hmm.
So we are kind of safe about our industry. But how we do business, probably we'll have to relook. But people will come back to our hotels. They'll still need the food, they'll still need to dine, they'll still need to use conference rooms. So it'll be there, but again, I'm saying, but when something like this happens, next time we should not be stuck in a position like this where we are so helpless and vulnerable. That's the only thing that I can say.
So we should put a disaster management plan after this.
Yes.
Probably under faith with the help of the government. Yeah. Thank you very much. And guys, if you have any views or suggestions, please write to us, switch2anddope.news. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.